Books on Tape presents Saving Millie, Love, Politics, and Parkinson's Disease by Morton Kondracke. Read by Michael Prichard. Foreword by Michael J. Fox. The morning I testified before a Senate subcommittee in support of increased federal funding for Parkinson's research, Mort Kondracke did me the same great favor he is about to do for you. He introduced me to Millie. I first met Mort just a week or so prior to the hearing. He had been among a small contingent from the Parkinson's Action Network who had flown to New York to prepare me for my testimony. When Joan Samuelson, PAN's founder, mentioned that Mort would be accompanying them, I was surprised and curious as to his connection to the cause. His wife has PD. He's very passionate. Passionate? Mort Kondracke, passionate? As a bit of a political junkie myself, I was familiar with Mort through his writing and work on the McLaughlin Group, and it was precisely his lack of passion, his steady unflappability in the midst of all the barbs and bombast that pass for political punditry, that I had always admired. Mort's appearance and demeanor at that preliminary briefing in my New York apartment supported this impression. Crisp and composed, with inscrutable eyes blinking owlishly behind oversized glasses, his hair combed perfectly into a low sweep across his forehead, Mort remained a quiet observer much of the meeting. I had to fight the occasional juvenile impulse to tilt my head in his direction, and in the manner of Dana Carvey channeling John McLaughlin, bark out, "Over to you, Morton!" When he felt it was time to contribute to the discussion, Mort chimed in with obvious authority about the machinations of Washington, D.C., and, specifically, the politics of Parkinson's advocacy. Who's helping us? Who's hurting us? And who's holding us up by simply refusing to take a position? Historically, the PD community has been slighted when it comes time to disperse government research dollars, and Mort rattled off from memory the budget figures supporting this claim. Expressing sincere regret about my Parkinson's diagnosis, he nevertheless frankly and forthrightly strategized how best to convert my celebrity status into lobbying capital on Capitol Hill. Intelligent, illuminating, insightful, sitting there at my dining room table, Mort Kondracke was also, in a word, passionate. And so began my tutelage under Professor Kondracke, continuing in Washington on the morning of my appearance before the Senate Appropriations Subcommittee on Labor, Health, and Human Services and Education. As we wound our way through the literal corridors of power, Mort peppered me with information, pausing only to introduce me to this senator, that committee member, and ultimately the committee chairman himself, Senator Arlen Specter. Amid a riot of flashbulbs, I made my way into the crowded hearing room toward our panel's microphone-cluttered conference table. But Mort wasn't done with me yet. There's one more person I want you to meet. Cupping my elbow with one hand, locking it into place with the other, Mort shepherded me toward a bright-eyed, silver-haired woman seated in a wheelchair at the end of the first row. It was Millie. It is rare that a husband would introduce his wife to another man, a younger one at that, and then report with almost giddy satisfaction how instantly and profoundly the two were taken with each other. Mort sensed a strong and immediate connection, and he wasn't mistaken. That first meeting initiated an exchange between Millie and me, a conversational thread that would be picked up over the course of subsequent encounters. Millie has inspired, encouraged, and commiserated with me. She has brought into sharper focus my personal understanding of such concepts as commitment, passion, dedication, suffering, perseverance, love, loyalty, and hope. Millie has taught me that one's dignity may be assaulted, vandalized, and cruelly mocked, but cannot be taken away unless it is surrendered. Physically weakened but possessed of a fierce inner strength, Millie Kondracke has weathered immeasurable loss. But that is one sacrifice she is not prepared to make. What is truly remarkable is that Millie has shared so much with me without ever uttering one clearly audible word. Robbed of the freedom to express her ideas, feelings, and desires, she's bursting with all three. Millie's powerful presence, combined with the depth of our common experience as Parkinson's patients, accounts for her ability to communicate so much to me in the time we've spent together. While prior to picking up this book, you probably knew a little bit about me, and presumably something about Mort, it's a safe bet you knew nothing at all about Millie. Once you read her story, you'll never forget her. At its core, this is a love story, poignantly told. Mort writes of his devotion to Millie with eloquence and surprising candor. From the more intimate details of their virginity to Viagra romance, to the strengthening of his commitment, as together they face the cataclysm of Parkinson's disease. Thank you, Mort, for saving Millie. And thank you, Millie, for the love and passion you've inspired in others. I believe, as do you and Mort, that a cure for Parkinson's disease is very close, and in a very real way, you've brought it that much closer. So, who's saving whom? Michael J. Fox, New York City, February 2001. Introduction. Parkinson's disease has kidnapped my wife. It is in the process of killing her. I hug and kiss what is left of her, hang photographs of the old, strong Millie throughout the house, and talk to her. We hold hands. We make love. But she is not who she was. She cannot walk, and now she can barely speak. She is being carried into an abyss, and I am helpless to rescue her. I hate Parkinson's disease for what it has done to my beloved and is doing to 1 million other Americans. It is a horrible story I have to tell you, but it is also an inspiring one. For what I had and what I still have, I feel profound gratitude. Millicent Martinez was a poor inner-city Chicago kid who grew up to be a dynamo. I wanted to marry an heiress from the Ivy League, but she was irresistible. Besides, I became convinced that God wanted this marriage to happen. So we married. Then we fought and loved each other in one way for 20 years, and in quite another for the past 13. Until she was 47, Millie was always the master of her surroundings, the kind of woman whose will no bureaucrat, lazy tradesman, or alcoholic husband could resist. She saved Andrea, our youngest daughter, who's dyslexic, from being discarded by the school system. Andrea is now graduating from medical school at Johns Hopkins. Millie emptied my liquor bottles down the drain and railed until I went into AA, which changed my life and may have saved it. Millie's Parkinson's diagnosis in 1988 shattered her confidence, but it did not stop her from fighting. A gifted psychotherapist who helped people remake their lives, she worked as long as she could. She underwent 2-day-long deep brain operations, awake throughout. She importuned a president, testified before Congress, and cried in senators' offices to secure increased funding for Parkinson's research. Her plight transformed me. From her resentful assistant, I became her dedicated partner. I came out of self-absorption and became an activist in the cause of medical research funding, not just for Parkinson's, but for all diseases. I call that cause God's work. It has heroes and heroines, and it is succeeding. If Congress and the President continue on the path of the past 3 years, they will double the budget of the National Institutes of Health. Then they should do it again. Millie's disease destroyed her trust in God. She feels that He is punishing her, but she does not know why. Parkinson's has had a different effect on my faith. I feel that I need to talk to God every day and ask for His help. Every time I have asked God what my job.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.